Blackstone Publishing presents All About All About Eve, the complete behind-the-scenes story of the bitchiest film ever made, by Sam Staggs. This book is read by Donald Corren. To Robert Sanchez, Glenn Russell, Evan Matthews, Steve Lambert, Tim Boss, Carrie Birdwell, John Conway, Gary Schwartz, and Warren Butler, who know all about movies. Author's note. Since All About Eve is, to me, one of the most entertaining movies ever made, I have tried to write an entertaining book about it. I like to think of my work as fan scholarship, or even camp scholarship, and why not? Surely a book about a particular movie should echo the voice of the movie itself. To come at a Hollywood classic from every angle, as I've attempted to do, you have to immerse yourself in all aspects of the production, as the movie makers did. It's necessary to memorize the script, to learn your way around the sets and observe carpenters, electricians, stylists, and script girls. Study every performance. You have to become a shadow director as well as a shadow star, someone who sees everything but who remains out of camera range. My chief method in tracing the root of All About Eve has been a production history of the film. The complete story, however, began long before anyone conceived such a picture and continues long after, through the Broadway musical Applause and including quotations, references, and allusions to Eve right up to the present day. I wanted to write not as a detached observer, but rather from the point of view of an audience member trying to figure out why I like the movie so much and why I still find it fresh after 30 or 40 viewings. My approach is emotional. That's the fan response. But without research and a rigorous quest for accuracy and balance, the entire book might amount to little more than a studio press release. Writing about the Hollywood of 50 years ago is a slippery job at best because so many of the people and the documents are gone. And of course, those in the motion picture industry, like the rest of us, have remembered what was favorable to themselves. Each one framed his or her narrative with an eye to flattering close-ups. In trying to separate fact from myth, I have retained a constant skepticism. Many of the anecdotes recounted here derive, with variations, from several sources. I've also included several from a single source, and a few from sources not entirely convincing. The quotes from various persons connected with All About Eve sometimes sound scripted, but they're real. I might have caught a glimpse of the heart of the mystery from the rear, an unflattering angle which paradoxically has always excited me, possibly because it is in some way involved with my passion for backstage, for observing what is magic from the unusual, privileged angle. Gore Vidal, Myra Breckenridge. Chapter 1. Fire and Music. 1951. A terse headline in Variety on September 27, 1951, told the news. Mankiewicz 20th sever contract. Many in the industry were surprised that Joseph L. Mankiewicz, the Hollywood director and screenwriter, was quitting 20th Century Fox, where he had spent the better part of a decade. His separation from Fox was amicable, as such things go. His valedictory to Los Angeles, less so. Mankiewicz referred to the City of Angels as an intellectual fog belt. Manhattan, he felt sure, would salute him. There he could breathe finer air. He expected to be smartly quoted all over town, and when he tossed out a bon mot, his New York listeners wouldn't miss a beat. Nor would anyone complain, "What's that supposed to mean?" as they had done since his first day in the intellectual fog belt. Two Beacons moving vans that would transport everything the Mankiewicz family owned across the country to their new home in New York were packed. One van was filled with household goods. The other contained what was irreplaceable: the writings of Joseph L. Mankiewicz, his papers, his many awards and citations. Mankiewicz told a reporter he was off to Broadway to make my pitch for the theater. Although he spent the rest of his life in New York, he never completed a play, and he never directed one. 1995. Celeste Holm, in her apartment on Central Park West, answered the phone herself. After hearing a description of the book in progress titled All About Eve, she asked, "Why the hell do you want to write that book?" "Why? Because millions of people love the movie. And also because no one has told the story of how it came about and why All About Eve is considered both a Hollywood classic and a cult film." "I don't get it," she snapped. "A work of art speaks for itself. I think a book like that is a waste of time. If people are interested, let them see the movie." "I've seen it 30 times. Then see it 30 more." "Look, Miss Holm, it's not backstairs gossip I'm after. But since Mankiewicz lost all his papers in the fire, I guess you want to talk to me about Bette Davis?" Celeste Holm demanded. And without waiting for an answer, she continued, "I've talked to everybody in the world about that movie." "Bette Davis? No. I'd rather hear about you. All this crap about books, I don't get it." "Suppose I send you a detailed letter about the book. Your memories of shooting All About Eve are important." "Well, maybe, I don't know. Goodbye." She never answered the letter. 1996. Told about the unproductive phone conversation with Celeste Holm, Kenneth Geist, Joseph L. Mankiewicz's biographer, remarked, "When you're the last Mankiewicz survivor in New York, you've probably had enough." 1976. "I'm not a dinosaur, you know," harumphed Celeste Holm, when a reporter in Los Angeles asked her if All About Eve is the movie people best remember her for. "Oh, didn't you see Tom Sawyer last year?" she scolded. "I played Aunt Polly. That was a hit, too. Actually, I can tell a lot about somebody just from the movie of mine he mentions first. If you like All About Eve so much, probably means you're a Bette Davis nut, a late show freak. The Broadway musical fans want to know about my playing Ado Annie in the original production of Oklahoma. And the socially conscious crowd, the urban liberals, talk about Gentlemen's Agreement." 1951. Volumes of plays, Ibsen, Oscar Wilde, Kaufman and Hart, Rostand, Molière, Beaumont and Fletcher, even Clyde Fitch and old melodramas, all of these crackled in the fire as if this were Berlin in 1933. Theater histories, the works of Sigmund Freud, scripts and diaries, biographies of Minnie Fisk and Sarah Siddons and the Barrymores, blazed up for a few minutes and then were gone. Mementos saved from movie sets melted like candle wax. The fire grew and fattened, consuming every molecule of oxygen. It lapped up half a lifetime of memories. The highway itself seemed on fire, while inside the overturned Beacons van, ugly smoke gnawed away at wooden crates, cardboard boxes, and metal file cabinets, which, despite their greater strength, would not survive. A distant siren started up as photographs of Bette Davis charred in the flames like bacon strips. Nearby, a carton flared.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.